Hello, everybody. If I can have your attention, please. Good afternoon. Welcome to sunny Austin, Texas, newly sunny Austin, Texas. For those of you who are local and know we've been, you know, dealing with a deluge the last week. But for our out-of-town and out-of-country visitors, the sun has come out just to the right time to welcome you and hopefully bode well for our conference the next few days. For those of you who don't know me, my name is Will Inboden. I'm a professor here at UT and the executive director of the Clements Center, one of your sponsoring organizations for today. And it's my great good privilege to introduce our inaugural speaker for the conference, Ambassador, Doctor, many other honorifics in front of him, Ken Adelman. As I was thinking about, I think the best way to introduce Ambassador Adelman, however, is this. Before Dos Equis beer gave us the most interesting man in the world, there was Ken Adelman. Not many other people can claim to have been the interpreter for Muhammad Ali in the Rumble in the Jungle in Zaire, the legendary heavyweight fight against George Foreman, to have sailed down the River Congo on the 100th anniversary of Sir Henry Stanley's expedition, that's right. He's taught Shakespeare as a member of the faculty at Georgetown University for many years. And somehow in the midst of all that, he managed to squeeze in a very distinguished career in government and public policy. For purposes of the Clements Center, I think the apotheosis of your career came in 1975 and 76 when you worked with Bill Clements at the Pentagon. It's been all downhill since then, right? No, because Clements, of course, is our namesake and was Deputy Secretary of Defense at the time. But among other senior government positions, he's been the U.S. Ambassador to the United Nations and in the Reagan administration was the Director of the Arms Control and Disarmament Agency, where, for purposes of his presentation today, he not only had a front row seat, but was deeply involved in the famous Reagan-Gorbachev summit at Reykjavik in 1986. And you'll hear a wonderful overview of that today from Ken, but that's just a teaser. You can get the full story in his wonderful book. It's a very elegantly crafted work of history, Reagan at Reykjavik, but it really reads like a fiction thriller. One of the best books I've read in the last couple years, and available on Amazon, I'm sure. So, Ambassador Adelman's gonna come up and lead us through a multimedia presentation, after which she'll be happy to take questions from the audience, and then he'll wrap up with a couple final minutes of formal presentation at the end, after which we will repair downstairs for brief refreshments, then we'll get the rest of the conference underway. So please join me in welcoming Ambassador Ken Adelman.
Thank you, Will. That's a wonderful introduction. That's better than an introduction I had in Tokyo and about 5 or 6 years ago. I was giving a lecture on security issues in Northeast Asia, North Korea and all that, and after the lecture, the head of the Tokyo Foreign Affairs Committee stood up and said, Ambassador Adelman, for your service and for your remarks, you deserve much clap. I told him, thank you very much. It's one of the things I didn't need very much, but he thought I was being modest, but I said, really, hold off the much clap, at least for a while. It is wonderful to be here. I come to you from Washington, D.C., going to be a big, busy city this weekend. People say Washington, D.C. is a city of great monuments and monumental egos. It's where politicians can go through the channel of the love and tunnel of love, holding their own hand, where you know a friend who stabs you in the front, where someone says, it never crossed my mind, and you think that's not a very far way to go, or someone, a politician or a lobbyist, is asked, where did all the money go that you made? And he said, well, to tell you the truth, 80% of it went for women and booze, and to tell you the truth, I just wasted the other 30%. So greetings from Washington, D.C. I have a story to tell you today about Reagan at Reykjavik, the great turning point, I think, in the whole Cold War and in Reagan's foreign policy that we're going to be talking about for the next 2.5 or 3 days. Will is absolutely right. I did work with Bill Clements And he was Deputy Secretary of Defense when I went over there with Don Rumsfeld, who was Secretary of Defense, and spent those times in 1975 and 76 and early in 1977 with him and admiring his work very much. So it's a great, great honor to speak at the Clements Center. Reagan at Reykjavik, I'm going to tell you the whole story. Before I do, however, I'm going to show you how relevant the story is to today. This is a article that was in the London Times. Yes, 2 days ago. It says Trump wants Putin summit in Reykjavik, and apparently, from the reports of the president-elect, he would like to duplicate what happened in 1986 and meet the Russian leader there. We can talk now, and especially at the question period, how much Reagan is like Trump or different from Trump, and how much the whole prospects of today are very different from what they were in 1986. But let's go through 1986 real quickly and what we can learn from 1986. The basic lessons are from this: make no small plans. Both leaders had very large plans when they went to Reykjavik in October of 1986, October 11th and 12th on that. Work out how to get there, how to go from here to there, something that Ronald Reagan was very good at doing, as you'll see over the next 2.5 days here at this Clements conference, but Gorbachev was not very good at doing. Third, trust the team. And on an all-night session at the middle of Reykjavik, you'll see how Reagan and actually Gorbachev trusted the team very nicely. Don't accept defeat. It was thought to be a tremendous failure right after the Reykjavik conference, but it turned around in the next year and became an enormous success. And lastly, stay the course. And we'll see how Ronald Reagan did that. One moment of background. The Cold War was chillier than ever when Ronald Reagan took office. And I think it's fair to say that he and his remarks made it even chillier, that he thought that the Soviet Union was the evil empire. It was the focus of evil in the modern world. His very first press conference in the White House, he said that the Soviets will cheat, lie, and steal to advance their interests anywhere around the world, which everybody in Washington had a collective gasp, could not believe that a president of the United States would say such a thing. Such gasps seem out of date, to tell you the truth, with what is incoming to the White House right now. But anyway, that would cause quite a stir at the time. There was a tremendous protest on nuclear issues in 1981 and 1982. I was at the UN, as Will said, there when 500,000 people protested in Central Park for the nuclear freeze and against Reagan foreign policies. It was very, very controversial. 1983 was a seminal year. This is the time Man of the Year, actually Men of the Year, and Andropov, who was the Soviet leader, and Reagan look like they are back-to-back going to have a duel, not with pistols, but with intercontinental ballistic missiles at the time. 1983 was a traumatic year. It was the year where the United States deployed Euro missiles. The Soviets walked out of all arms control talks because of the deployment of Euro missiles. It was the year when Ronald Reagan gave the speech in Florida proclaiming that the Soviet Union was the evil empire. It was the year when the Soviets shot down the Korean airliner, killing 200 innocent passengers, more than 200 innocent passengers. It was the year when the relationship really did seem like it was the worst of the Cold War era. Even before that time, Ronald Reagan had decided he wanted to change things in a fundamental way. One of the wonderful things about doing the research for the book that Will mentioned, Reagan at Reykjavik, was I found things out that I didn't know before, even though I was quite conversant to what happened at at Reykjavik over the weekend. For example, I did not know that before Ronald Reagan took office, he was intent on ending the Cold War. And even on the way to Detroit to accept the nomination as the Republican candidate for president in 1980, the summer of 1980, an associate of his asked Stuart Spencer, asked, "Why are you doing this, Ron? Why are you running for president? Why do you want to be president?" And without a hesitation, Reagan blurted out to end the Cold War. And Ronald Reagan had an idea, starting in the mid-1970s, how that would end. He said that we win and they lose. Okay? So it was in Reagan's mind that he was going to fundamentally change things. The opportunities really actually weren't there until something happened in 1985, when the whole succession of Soviet leaders ended, the old Soviet leaders ended. Do you remember that was a period when Brezhnev died and then Andropov, who we saw in that picture, took his place? Then after 14 months, Andropov died and Chernyenko took his place. And then soon thereafter, Chernyenko died. We were very good friends with the Italian ambassador to the United States. And he told me he was going off to Chernyenko's funeral in Moscow, as he had to Andropov's and Brezhnev's. And I said, "Why are you doing that?" And he says, "Ken, I bought tickets to the entire series." So there was a succession of Soviet leaders dropping dead. And Ronald Reagan at one point was asked why he didn't have a summit with the Soviet leaders. And he said, "Because they're all dying on me. Hey, what do you want me to do? They're all dying." But in March of 1985, a very young and vigorous Mikhail Gorbachev came to power. And it was exciting for all of us in government. Early in 1985, we spent 6 months planning the first Reagan-Gorbachev summit, which was held in mid-November of 1985. We spent 6 months because the Soviets wanted it to be a level playing field, that it was going to be in a neutral city, Geneva, in a neutral country, Switzerland, and even in a neutral house, not the American embassy or the Soviet embassy, but in a neutral house, which was the Aga Khan's great mansion in Geneva. Well, what happened that we planned out for 6 months, this level playing field, lasted about a minute and a half of the summit. And what happened was quite amazing. We were standing in the foyer of the Aga Khan's chateau on the Lake Geneva, talking to the president, who was talking about horseback riding or something, and all of a sudden a Secret Service fellow walked up to Reagan, and he said, "Mr. President, Mr. Gorbachev's car is coming around the driveway." And Reagan, without giving it a thought, headed out. Now, you have to understand the visuals of what happened that first 2 minutes of the summit. Here is Ronald Reagan, a man over 70 years old, by the time 1985, almost 75 years old, meeting with Mikhail Gorbachev, who's in his young 50s. Ronald Reagan is thought to be kind of tottering. Gorbachev is known to be very sharp, knows the issues, very appealing. And all of us who had known Reagan and worked with him for a number of years by that time, even we were kind of worried how he would handle a situation like that. We knew he could handle it very well with the Congress and Tip O'Neill and all that, but we were wondering how he would handle it in the really big leagues with the Soviet leader. All that ended in the first 2 minutes of the summit. And I'll let the Chief of Staff of the White House, Don Regan, describe what happened.
"We were waiting for General Secretary Gorbachev to arrive. President Reagan I was waiting inside the mansion. He had no coat on. He was asked, did he want to put a coat on? And while he was trying to make up his mind, the Secret Service announced that Gorbachev was there. So Reagan said, my heavens. He raced out the door without his overcoat, down the steps, and just as Gorbachev's limousine door opened, there was Reagan with his hand out, ready to greet him. Gorbachev was bundled up in a muffler, hat, overcoat. Reagan then put his hand under Gorbachev's arm and assisted him up the stairs.
I love the whole idea of him, just in case he needed a little boost to get up those stairs, he was there. And it was quite surprising to all of us who were watching this. It was even more surprising to the Soviets. Here's the Soviet spokesman who interprets what just happened.
I felt that we lost the game during this first movement. You can compare it with a chess game. We started with the wrong move.
But anyway, that summit was pretty standard, and it played out like most summits, with very little happening, which is just exactly the way the State Department planners wanted to happen. The next year, in the summer of 1986, Mikhail Gorbachev wrote Reagan that we should get off the dime and do something different. And just like Geneva was 6 months in the planning, the Reykjavik summit was about 10 days in the planning. It was a come-as-you-are, hurry-up summit. It was a summit that was decided at Reykjavik because it was halfway between Moscow and Washington. The president could have chosen London. Gorbachev said it could be London or Reykjavik. Reagan could have chosen London, but he was reluctant to go to London because he would have to deal with the Queen and deal with the Prime Minister Thatcher and deal with the NATO headquarters in Reykjavik. He really had to deal with nothing because there was almost nothing at Reykjavik. It was a country, it's a city of 125,000 in a country of 250,000, and it was very quaint, very lovely, but totally ill-equipped to handle a superpower summit. Here is Miss Iceland, who became 2 weeks before the summit Miss Universe. And she was called back from a goodwill tour in Asia to come to Reykjavik for the summit. I thought she'd make absolutely a fabulous cover for my book, and we could name it, Sex, Diplomacy, and Everything Else in Reykjavik, but somehow the publisher did not think that that was exactly on key for that. And she was not the only beautiful, wonderful woman in Reykjavik that weekend. It was also Raisa Gorbachev came. Now, we had understood in the White House that first ladies were not coming. This was not even going to be a summit. This was just going to be a meeting of the heads of government without all the fanfare and hoopla that comes in a summit. Nancy Reagan announced that she was not going to go because this was just a business meeting. She presumed that, and with some knowledge, that Raisa was not going to come. The plane opens, the door opens, and there is Raisa, which did not please Nancy Reagan at all. They had met the year before in Geneva, and they had taken a dislike to one another. A friend of ours who was in the Reagan administration at one point went to Bob Strauss, who is much beloved around here. And he said, Bob, I just don't understand. Why is it that everybody takes such an instantaneous dislike to me? And Bob Strauss, in his wonderful way, thought for a minute, and he says, because it saves them time. Nancy Reagan and Raisa Gorbachev saved a lot of time by taking an instant dislike to one another. So she was there, and Nancy Reagan was not, and was even more furious about the whole situation. As I said, the Iceland government was not equipped to handle a superpower summit. The prime minister of Iceland, which is not a very demanding job, was there and was asked if he could do an interview with Tom Brokaw to give a little background for the summit. And the prime minister's office said, fine. And Brokaw and NBC said, when would be best for the prime minister? And the prime minister said, you know, anytime you want, basically. And so they said, how about Friday morning, the day before the summit started, at 10 o'clock in the morning? The prime minister's office said that would be fine. That was actually the hour where the prime minister took his bath in the hot springs in Reykjavik, which is all around the city of Reykjavik. So they decided to proceed with the prime minister of Iceland giving an interview to the young Tom Brokaw there. I think it's the only international interview in a Speedo that has ever been done. I can't imagine why the press secretary right there would not say, let's get a towel or, you know, let's wait a few minutes till after he's through bathing. But anyway, that was the scene with the interview with the prime minister. The summit was going to be held downtown. The Iceland government announced it was going to be held in the new conference center that was advertised to be an international meeting place. This was one of the few things that the United States and Soviet Union agreed upon. They didn't want it downtown. They wanted it in an isolated place, as if Reykjavik was not isolated enough. So you have an isolated country on the Arctic Circle, Iceland, and an isolated city, but they wanted an isolated place in the city, and that was the Hofti House. The Hofti House is a beautiful house. I visited there about 2 months ago on the anniversary, the 30th anniversary of the Reykjavik summit. It's still absolutely a magnificent house. It's on the shores of the ocean. You can see right there near the Arctic Circle. It is a small house. You can see compared to the presidential limousine right there. Built in 1909, a wooden house, and it's used for these kind of meetings. I'll give you a real brief tour of the Hofti House. Right there is the Soviet parlor where the Soviet diplomats waited while the talks were going on. Right there was our parlor, the American parlor. You'll see inside there in a minute where we all retired to, and the president retired between his talks. Right between the two was a DMZ, the demilitarized zone, just like between East and West Germany or North and South Korea. Right there is the room where the two of them met, and we'll show you that. It's a very small room. They met, by the way, for 10 and a half hours over the weekend with the foreign ministers present, George Shultz and Edward Shevardnadze, but saying practically nothing. So here you had two heads of government meeting together for 10 and a half hours over a two-day time. Now, I don't know about you, but I have never talked to my wife for 10 and a half hours over a two-day period, and I think I'd drive her nuts if I did, but it's just a lot of conversation. Plus, what was unique about the Reykjavik summit, unlike Geneva and summits that have taken place since that time, was it was a hurry-up, come-as-you-are summit. There was very little preparation on our side for the summit. Consequently, there were really no briefing memos. There was no talking points. You had a situation in Geneva, in Reykjavik, where the two of them were more like themselves, franker, than any other time they were in office. And they said things that were direct. Ronald Reagan made a lot of comments that were against U.S. policy. Why is that? Because no one gave him the outlines of what the State Department policy was at that time. He just said what he wanted. So this wonderful story of the Reykjavik summit enables us to peek through the keyhole and listen in to the room where Gorbachev and Reagan are really saying what they mean rather than reading what their staff wants them to say or do. That was the meeting hall, the meeting room, and we'll see it's very small, a table that seats four. And then the most wonderful part of the Hofty House to me was the basement. In this half of the basement, the KGB had all their equipment up to the ceiling for communications and security. And in this part, the CIA had all of its equipment. This is a little house where they were jammed in the basement with a low ceiling together for 3 days with all this equipment within stone's throw, within, you know, the same room as each other. The basement of the Hofty House has two bathrooms. One is a lot bigger than the other. So in the preparation, the three-day preparation before getting there, the head of the CIA contingent and the KGB met with the caretaker of the Hofty House, and each of them, of course, wanted the larger bathroom. And they went back and forth, and finally, very graciously, the head of the KGB said, oh, just let's see what happens and just leave it go. And so it was fine. So I conclude from that that the intelligence agencies from around the world always operate on a need-to-know basis. That weekend in Reykjavik, the two main intelligence agencies from around the world operated on a need-to-go basis. And that's what happened in the basement right there. The time I told you was time frightful for the Cold War. And what was unique about the Hofty House, besides its beauty and its isolation, was that it was thought to be haunted. It was sold by the British back to the Reykjavik government because the British ambassador heard ghosts and things were falling off the walls and spirits were there, and he was totally spooked. And so the British government sold it, and the Hofty House was thought, even in 1986, to be haunted. It's not even called by the locals the Hofty House. It's called the Haunted House by the locals. Here is a cartoon at the time. You know they say this house is haunted. You want spooky. Imagine the place next door. It was at 10 o'clock in the morning on October 11th, 1986, that Reagan and Gorbachev met at the front door of the Hofty House. And what was unique about it was that they then proceeded to their small room, which I'm going to show you in a minute. And right behind them, walking, in behind each one was a colonel with a briefcase carrying the nuclear codes of the country to blow up the other country and maybe to blow up the world. And for the 10 and a half hours that they were in, actually, they met for 10 and a half hours, for the probably 15 or 16 hours that they were in the Hofty House, each of these colonels stood with his briefcase full of the nuclear codes just a few yards from each other, almost not looking at each other, right there. And when I saw that, it just gave me chills. So you had a room where the two leaders of the Soviet Union and the United States were talking about nuclear weapons. Outside their doors, you had the two colonels standing with suitcases full of codes on the nuclear weapons. And in the basement was all the communications and security issues to promulgate the orders that would come from those briefcases to blow up each country and the world. It was a chilling, chilling sight, and to me, one of the most memorable that happened in the Reykjavik summit weekend. Here is the room where they met. When I say make no small plans, we did not expect that this was going to be a momentous event. In fact, the White House spokesman said it's not even a summit. It's a meeting to prepare for the summit. But the Soviet side, especially Mikhail Gorbachev, came and literally dumped his briefcase full of proposals that surprised us very much. Here is Ronald Reagan, Mikhail Gorbachev there. translator there. Edward Shevardnadze, who died about 6 months ago, foreign minister of the Soviet Union. George Shultz, who's still going strong at 95, and was very gracious when the book came out, did a book party in San Francisco and said all kinds of wonderful things about the book, and it's a great tale. After their first meeting on the Saturday morning, we were summoned to go into the bubble by Secretary Shultz. Now, a bubble is a room within a room in every embassy around the world that is absolutely secure. Its walls are about this thick. It has all kinds of equipment inside the wall that is plastic and it off the ground, so it's impossible to penetrate. The bubble we had in Geneva sat about 25 or 26 around a conference table. So during our negotiations, we could meet in the bubble knowing that it was absolutely secure from Soviet bugs or the host government bugs and speak our mind to one another. In Reykjavik, of course, where not much ever happened, this was the smallest bubble ever made. So when we got in, there were four folding chairs, steel gray folding chairs, very little, smaller than the chairs you're sitting on now, on one side, and four on the other side. And all of us were cramped with our shoulders next to each other. And the crank was closed on the bubble so that we were all in there quite secure. And George Shultz started to tell us what was happening in there. As we're going into the bubble, the crank is closed on the bubble. All of a sudden, it opens up again, and a Secret Service man is standing there and saying, "The President of the United States." Now we had eight chairs and nine of us. And so I decided if I was to stay in the bubble, because the bubble was the White House Chief of Staff, it was the National Security Advisor, the Secretary of State, the President of the United States, and they were going nowhere. While I was not exactly chopped liver, I wasn't at the height of this food chain at all. So I decided if I was going to stay in the bubble, and by God, I decided I was going to stay in the bubble, I hit the ground and here on the side and said, "Right here, Mr. President," and offered him his chair. Ronald Reagan, who was a big man, kind of looked and turned around, kind of aimed for the chair because it was hard to miss, and hit it. And for the next about 40 minutes, I was sitting, leaning against the presidential knees while we talked about how to respond to Mikhail Gorbachev's interesting ideas that we had not expected at all from that summit. Work out how to get there. Mikhail Gorbachev wanted, Ronald Reagan wanted several things in arms control. First thing he really wanted was real reductions of nuclear weapons. Until Reykjavik, the whole idea of the United States-Soviet arms control was to limit the growth of Soviet and American nuclear weapons. In other words, if we were going to grow at 5%, an arms control agreement would say we would grow at 3%, something like that. Ronald Reagan came along and said he wasn't willing to limit the growth. He wanted real reductions. We changed the name of the talks from SALT, the Strategic Arms Limitation Talks, to START, the Strategic Arms Reduction Talks. And that was a fundamental innovation of Ronald Reagan. Secondly, Reagan wanted a big military buildup to really press the Soviet Union through peace, through strength, which he started in 1981, the big military buildup that the Soviets could not match. Thirdly, Ronald Reagan's rhetoric was delegitimizing the Soviet Union, calling it the evil empire, the center of evil in the modern world. Every president before that time, including Richard Nixon, with Henry Kissinger, including Jimmy Carter, including Gerald Ford. Every president before that time thought the United States and the Soviet Union were the two superpowers. We had to get along with them. We didn't want to blow up the world, all that. Therefore, we both had to sign off on something that was important in the world. Ronald Reagan came along and said, I understand the power realities, but we're legitimate because our government is elected by the people, and they're illegitimate. So they questioned their very legitimacy on that. And fourthly, the great innovation of the Reagan administration, besides deep reductions in nuclear arms, a overall military buildup, delegitimization of the concept of the Soviet Union. The fourth was SDI, the Strategic Defense Initiative, a defensive program that would allow us to defend the country against incoming ballistic missiles. This was Ronald Reagan's idea, promoted in that tumultuous year of 1983, March of 1983, and set the world on fire because of the opposition from domestically, from a lot of people in the United States, to change strategic posture, and especially from the Soviet Union that knew it could not compete with us in our one area of strength, which was technological competence. The Soviets went crazy about SDI. And over that weekend, SDI dominated the talk, even though it was a very small research program in the Pentagon that none of the services, the Army, Navy, and the Air Force, really didn't want. But Ronald Reagan really did want it and promoted it. This comes out in a great slide, a cartoon, that you have Mikhail Gorbachev saying, and anyway, we don't think such a crazy thing could ever work. You got a light. He has a cigarette right there. Reagan says, sure. He contacts the SDI satellite right there, which lights the cigarette. And then Reagan turns to the camera and says the Star Wars stuff drives him nuts. And certainly the Star Wars stuff did drive him nuts. They spend all that Saturday going back and forth, and then they decided, at the suggestion of some members of our group, why don't we have an experts group that night at the Hofty House to see if we can bridge the difference between what Gorbachev wants and what Reagan wants. We met at 8 o'clock at night in the Hofty House. We took a break at 3:15 in the morning. We broke those talks at 6:20 in the morning. And I was back in the bubble at 8:30, and I said, Mr. President, we have accomplished more last night than we have in 7.5 years of negotiations in Geneva. The Soviets were buying on to deep reductions in strategic arms and buying on to what Reagan originally proposed in 1981 as the zero option for Euro missiles in the United States, in Western Europe, and the eastern part of the Soviet Union. At Sunday morning, they went back. We were surprised to find that all of our accomplishments on Saturday night were now tied to a resolution on SDI, the Strategic Defense Initiative. And the resolution that Gorbachev wanted was to eliminate SDI, to scrap the program. So what we thought we had accomplished on Saturday night was now held hostage to that. Ronald Reagan was not about to give up SDI. It's a dream he had. It's a program he felt very strongly about. They negotiated all Sunday morning, hot and heavy. Then they decided to do something that was unique in the annals of symmetry, and I don't think it's been replicated since, not certainly not before, but even since. They decided to go into sudden death overtime. And where the summit was supposed to stop at noon, they decided to have an afternoon session. The whole world was operating and watching what would happen. I told you that Reykjavik was ill-equipped to handle this onslaught. In fact, the United States and even the Soviet Union, the Prime Minister, the Foreign Minister of the Soviet Union, Shevardnadze, said this is not going to be much interest to the international press, and just a few dozen reporters will cover it. By the time the summit opened, there were 3,217 journalists and media people in Reykjavik to cover the summit. The CNN was covering it almost nonstop. All three anchors from CBS, ABC, and NBC were there to cover it. It was a gigantic thing. So they were all interested in getting interviews after the noon breakup of the summit, but we decided to go, the president decided to go into overtime at 2 o'clock that day. Then at about 3:30 or quarter to 4, Ronald Reagan took the steps up from the meeting room on the Hofty House, steps up to meet with us in that afternoon. Here is meeting in the corner. Reagan plopped down in that chair. It had been a long day. We had briefed him at 8:30 in the morning, and now it was quarter to 4. He had been on the whole day. He plopped in the chair, and he says, I'll go down there one more time to meet with Gorbachev, but then that's it. He said, I promised Nancy I would be home for dinner tonight, and I want to keep that promise. I said, Mr. President, Mrs. Reagan's going to know where you are. It's not like you stopped in a bar on the way home from work. Just look outside at all those journalists there. And he said, I know, but I really want to have dinner with Nancy tonight. So we have here, that's Paul Nitze, who had been in our all-night session. Don Regan, the chief of staff, who had not. George Shultz, the secretary of state, who had not. John Poindexter, the national security advisor, who was not, and a young and dark-haired Ken Adelman. That was before I started dyeing my hair, so I would look distinguished at Clements Center and places like that. the president decided he was going to give it one more time. We all stood up, and we said, good luck, Mr. President. We knew it was going to be a big moment for him. We knew it was going to be a big moment for us. We knew it was going to be a big moment in the history of the Cold War and the history of the world. He said, thank you. He then leaves that room in the second floor parlor. And then within 15 seconds, we're all sitting down. I was personally exhausted. I had never done an all-nighter in my life, even in college, so I had missed that college ritual. But I was really kind of pooped because we came in town Thursday night. Friday night, we got very little sleep. Saturday was the all-nighter that ended at 6:20 in the morning, and here we were on Sunday afternoon. We stood there. All of a sudden, Ronald Reagan comes back in the room after we said, good luck, Mr. President, and all sat down in silence. We stood in a circle. And he said, I just want to make sure, in a moment like this, that we're doing right by America. He knew that in a tense situation like that, people get carried away in their emotions. In any negotiations, you want to conclude it. And you want to get a yes, even though it may not be of interest. So what he wanted to do was kind of pause and reflect on what we were doing. And he asked each of us in turn, are you comfortable with what we're doing? George, what do you think? Don, what do you think? Ken, what do you think? And around. And since that time, the 30 years since then, I've thought to myself, what a wonderful lesson in leadership to really check at a critical, critical moment. And I could never understand, till I went back to Reykjavik, what made him do this after 15 seconds after leaving. And then when I went back on the 30th anniversary, I actually went back on the 10th anniversary, and then just now, last October, when he's going downstairs, there's a big window right there. That's kind of odd. And out that window, you can see 3,000 journalists on the lawn. So he must have seen that and then got the idea, which he probably had before, oh my God, this is a very big moment, and turned around. We said good luck again, Mr. President. He left, actually, for the last time. We sat down in our chairs in that parlor for, I think it was about 40 minutes, absolutely saying nothing to each other, just kind of staring out, wondering what in the world was happening in the floor below. Finally, after that 40 minutes or so, the door bursts open. One of these gigantic Secret Service guys says, "They've broken." Kind of an odd phrase. We rush to the door. I was standing next to another participant in the arms talks, the American, and I looked at Ronald Reagan's face in the hall. I said, "It's no deal." There in the hall was Reagan lecturing Gorbachev, red face, kind of really mad that it didn't work out. Gorbachev was nice. He walked Reagan out to the car in the driveway. He said to him, "Mr. President, I don't know what we could have done differently." Ronald Reagan took his finger, pointed it right at Gorbachev's chest, said, "Well, you could have said yes," and then just got in the car. It was a wonderful John Wayne moment for Ronald Reagan at a critical time. We all rushed to the embassy where the president was staying. I should tell you that I told you that the summit was planned 10 days in advance. About right when it was announced, the Secret Service went to our U.S. ambassador, very, very nice man, who said the summit is going to take place in Reykjavik. He said, "Oh my God, this is beyond my wildest dream. The Secret Service says the president is going to be staying in your house." And the ambassador was absolutely euphoric. And they said, "Well, the bad news is you're not going to be staying in your house." And he says, "What do you mean?" And he says, "You know, there's just no room for you and the president and the Secret Service and the communications people and the blah, blah, blah." So he left town, and we never saw him again that weekend. So I don't think he could get a room. It was all booked up at that time, and the poor fellow was a nice man who deserved better treatment at the one weekend where U.S. Soviet relations happened in Iceland. He was nowhere to be seen. But anyway, after this, we rushed to the ambassador's house where the president was staying and the ambassador was not, and saw Ronald Reagan pacing up and down, absolutely livid. He had gotten his Irish blood really flowing. His face was all red. And right at that time, the announcement came around the world that the summit was a failure. Just headlines everywhere was no deal. Star Wars sinks the summit. Get this, it wasn't Gorbachev tying what we wanted, real reductions, to Star Wars, which sunk the summit. Something that was surprising to us on Sunday morning, it was Star Wars itself sunk the summit. Anyway, it was the big failure. There was not going to be a communication. There was not going to be a toasting with champagne glasses and clicking of glasses. There was not going to be, "Let's meet again in a few months." In fact, Don Regan, the White House chief of staff, said these two men will never meet again. He gave that interview from Reykjavik. I was on with Peter Jennings between a football game, actually, and he said, "What was it?" I said it was a tremendous success, that they had agreed to real reductions in a way that had never happened before. They had agreed to get rid of the Euro missiles in Europe, which had never happened before. And I understand they're tying it now to SDI, but the fact is that they'll give up on tying it to SDI. So while I was proclaiming this as a summit success with Peter Jennings on ABC, Don Regan was on CBS saying it was the biggest failure in the world. But this was kind of typical of the Reagan administration, where it was kind of do as you think best kind of administration. Ronald Reagan got in this car. We didn't speak to him at all because he was furious. Took the 30-mile ride to the Keflavik Airport. Was, according to Don Regan, who rode with him, furious the whole time, talking about what might have been, what might have been. Just very agitated. And he was then told on that car ride out there that he had agreed before to meet with the men and women of the armed forces who were stationed in Reykjavik at the hangar. They had been waiting 7.5 hours at the hangar because of the overtime, sudden death overtime of the summit. Reagan was furious until he stood before the troops and their families, and then all of a sudden he became Ronald Reagan again. And don't accept defeat. He told a wonderful story about saluting and how he had first gone to the commandants of the Marine Corps when he became president. And the commandant, Reagan says, you know what? I've always loved saluting. And when he was in the Army Corps during World War II, and he says, but I know enough to say that you need to be in a uniform before you salute. And I want to salute, but I'm not in a uniform, but I'm still in the military as commander-in-chief. And the commandant of the Marine Corps said, well, Mr. President, if you start saluting, I don't think anybody would mind. And he said, oh, thank you very much. And after that conversation, he saluted anything that ever moved. And he loved saluting. So here, you know, with all these privates and technicians at Reykjavik and their family, he's saluting away and telling that story and absolutely loved it. Reykjavik summit was a big failure. It was going to be a failure. It was going to be known as a failure around the world. And remained that way for about 2 months till the Soviets decided to reconstitute the arms talks. Meanwhile, Ronald Reagan had been invited to go to Berlin on the 750th anniversary of Berlin, and he said no, he refused to go. He had been to Berlin twice before as president, he didn't need to go again. Helmut Kohl called him up and said, you know, this is the 750th anniversary, I really want you to go to Berlin. Anytime Reagan was asked directly, would you do me a favor kind of thing, he was a softy. And he said to Kohl, okay. In April, they started planning for the trip to Berlin. And Reagan, speechwriter, says you'll need a toast for this, you'll need it for that and everything else. And you're going to give a speech at the wall. What do you want to say? Reagan, without really thinking very much, said, I'll tell you what I've wanted to say. I wanted to say for some time, tear down this wall. They said, holy cow, you want to say that? And then from that April till June was a civil war in the White House and the administration like you've never seen before. The State Department and virtually the rest of the government thought that was very provocative to say. The speech writers, who were a nice little clique of conservatives in the White House, heard the president and they said, let's do it. It sounds like a great idea. At some point between the 23 or 25 drafts that were going back and forth, every time State Department would kick out that line, they'd be back in the speechwriters and they'd put it back in. At some point in these negotiations, someone put in Mikhail Gorbachev's name, which made it even worse, even personal, and so it was thought to be outrageous. This continued, like many things in the Reagan administration, without the president really wanting to end the dispute by deciding, just let it happen. In the limousine on the way to the speech, the deputy chief of staff of the White House says to him, Mr. President, and Ronald Reagan is kind of daydreaming, looking out the window, and he says, Mr. President, a lot of people don't want that line in the speech. They think it's harmful, especially if you mention Gorbachev's name. Reagan turns around and looks over and says, I think it's the right thing to do. And then he goes back to daydreaming. In the scene on June 17th, 1987, 6 months after the Reykjavik summit, is Ronald Reagan at the wall, staying the course on what he believes. Against all advice of his advisors, especially using Gorbachev's name, Ronald Reagan said what he wanted to.
General Secretary Gorbachev, if you seek peace, if you seek prosperity for the Soviet Union and Eastern Europe, if you seek liberalization, come here to this gate. Mr. Gorbachev, open this gate. Mr. Gorbachev, tear down this wall.
The big dispute, as I told you, was whether to use Gorbachev's name. Ronald Reagan gave his answer. He didn't use it once. He used it twice, in case anybody missed it. That was in June of 1987. It was thought to be disastrous for him to say that. We got busy very quickly thereafter. Soviets dropped their ties to crimping SDI. They went back to what we had agreed at Reykjavik for the deep reductions in strategic nuclear weapons, almost half, and to the Euro missile situation for the zero option that he had proposed in 1981, and a hurry-up summit was going to be held in December of 1987 in Washington, D.C. It was a great event. The Gorbachevs arrived at Andrews Air Force Base, and the Reagans broke most protocol by coming out to the airport to greet them. And you can see the first ladies are right there with their warm and wonderful relationship that they had always. And this was at the welcoming ceremony. So you can imagine at the unwelcoming parts what their relationship was like. But that was the ladies. The men got along very well, especially on December 8th, 1987, when they signed the INF Treaty, the Intermediate Nuclear Force Treaty, which is the only arms control agreement in history to eliminate an entire class of nuclear weapons, the Euro missiles. And they had fun doing it. It was done in the east room of the White House. There is the cabinet and the vice president in the first row. The second row is that familiar list of CIA and KGB agents that got to know each other in the basement of the Hofty House. And the third row are the worker bees. There's Colin Powell, Paul Nitze, myself, Max Campbellman, and others right there. But it was just a great, great day. What happened in the nuclear stockpile since that time has been a real decline in nuclear weapons. You can see that it has gone down even further from that in the Obama years, and Reykjavik was the high point, especially for the Russian and USSR nuclear weapons. Today, Russia has about 20% of the number of nuclear weapons they had at the time of Reykjavik. The United States probably has 25% of that. That was the summit in December of 1987. In the summer of 1988, Ronald Reagan went for a return summit to Moscow. He stood at Moscow State University under a 6-foot statue of Lenin and a hammer and sickle, talking about the virtues of free enterprise and freedom. It was a magnificent magnificent event that sent a thrill to all of us. Him talking about our values as a country in the heart of the Soviet Union. That was in 1988, the very next year, the biggest surprise of our life happened when on November 9th, the wall fell. It was a great event. I was in Hungary at the time, had not seen the news overnight, and the deputy foreign minister of the Hungarian government told me that the wall had fallen the night before. And it was a situation that we couldn't even comprehend because we thought, unlike what Ronald Reagan thought, that the Cold War was going to be forever. One of the most wonderful parts of the fall of the wall was Rostropovich, the great cellist, the conductor of the National Symphony Orchestra, a Russian-born himself, had been in Europe giving a concert. He saw the wall fell. He jumped on a plane, went to the wall, said, "All I need is a chair." Someone got him a chair, and for the next 2 hours, he played Bach on the cello, unaccompanied cello music by Bach to express the amazing sensation he felt. With the fall of the wall, we thought nothing could ever be better. And on that, as in so many other things, we were just wrong. Because within 2 years, something amazing, more amazing than the fall of the wall, happened, and it was the fall of the Soviet Union. On Christmas Day, 1991, the hammer and sickle flag was brought down from the ceiling, from the roof of the Kremlin. That was a wonderful, wonderful event in 1991. 3 years later, and I'm so glad that Ronald Reagan got to see that, the realization of his plans and even his dreams when he was president, even before he was president. Within a few years, Ronald Reagan, who was sitting at his desk in Los Angeles, decided it was time for the great communicator to make his last communications to the American people. Took out a piece of paper from his desk drawer and sat there and wrote out his last communications to the American people, a letter that he had composed. This was not from a speechwriter. This was not from anybody else. You'll see that words are misspelled. Some of the words are crossed out. And he issued it to the press that very day.
November 5th, 1994. My fellow Americans, I have recently been told that I am one of the millions of Americans who will be afflicted with Alzheimer's disease. Unfortunately, as Alzheimer's disease progresses, the family often bears a heavy burden. I only wish there was some way I could spare Nancy from this painful experience. When the time comes, I am confident that with your help, she will face it with faith and courage. In closing, let me thank you, the American people, for giving me the great honor of allowing me to serve as your president. When the Lord calls me home, whenever that may be, I will leave the greatest love for this country of ours and eternal optimism for its future. I now begin the journey that will lead me into the sunset of my life. I know that for America, there there will always be a bright dawn ahead. Thank you, my friends. Sincerely, Ronald Reagan.
It's a beautiful letter. It was very, very moving. 2 years later, there was a 10th anniversary reunion at the Hofti House, where the Iceland government invited the American delegation and the Soviet delegation. And sitting there listening to various papers like you're going to have at the Clements Center over the next 3 days, I just was very moved, especially when walking around the Hofti House, seeing the room where the two of them met for 10 and a half hours, going back to the parlor where we sat waiting for the president, and finally said on Sunday afternoon, good luck, Mr. President, knowing it was a big moment. Going down to the basement where it was divided in half between the KGB and the CIA. And I was moved in a way that I've never been moved before, almost like a pilgrim which would feel going to the holy sites. I left the Hofti House, walked down the main avenue into town in my hotel room, and stopped and got a postcard. I didn't know the addressee of the address where I was going to send the postcard, but I wrote a postcard and mailed it. A week later, I was at the Reagan Library for a conference on the 10th anniversary of Reagan. And there, ambling down the hall, was a very frail Mrs. Ronald Reagan, Nancy Reagan. And I went up to her, and she said, oh, Ken, I heard you were just in Reykjavik on the 10th anniversary. And I said, I was. She said, well, tell me about it. And I said, well, before I do, let me tell you about the postcard I sent to your husband. She looked at me, startled, and said, you sent a postcard to my husband? Just kind of thinking, you know, he doesn't read postcards anymore. Didn't you get the message? And she said, well, and kind of agitated, and she said, well, what'd you say? And I said, I didn't have the address or anything, so I just wrote it. Ronald Reagan, President Ronald Reagan, Presidential Library. And I said, Mr. President, I'm here on the 10th anniversary of the Reykjavik Summit, thinking of the amazing job you did and how very proud I was to serve you. Best wishes, Ken Adelman. With that, she burst out crying. I kind of joined her. It was a tender moment to think about somebody who was so special in both of our lives. That was in 1996. Just a few years after that, what Nancy Reagan called the long goodbye finally ended. In June of 2004, Ronald Reagan took his last breath. There was an outpouring of sentiment for the president over a two-day period. We were very honored, my wife and I, to go to the National Cathedral for the funeral of the president. And we're very moved. But what really moved me what was happening the day before the funeral. Unannounced and really unanticipated, landing at what became Washington Ronald Reagan National Airport was a private plane, and in it was Mikhail Gorbachev. He came down, he went to the Capitol where the casket was lying in state at that time. He was recognized there. He was brought in inside the honor guard, and he stood there for about 2 minutes outside the casket, looking at it. Then he approached it, and he started rubbing back and forth on the stripes of the flag for over the casket of the 40th president of the United States. When I think back to that time, it was a miraculous time where two men with opposite views of the world really reconciled, treated each other with utmost respect, maintained their ideologies and their differences, but worked out something that made the world a lot safer. Since that time, Mikhail Gorbachev has been asked probably scores of times the following question. When you came in, it was a real chilly Cold War. When you left, there was really the end of the Cold War. In fact, the end of the Soviet Union. In fact, what really changed? And he always answers the same thing, Reykjavik. Reykjavik changed everything. And I think of that, and I was just lucky to be in that moment when Reykjavik changed everything. What I'd like to do now is take a few of your questions, and then I have a treat that I have for you that'll just take 2 minutes at the end. So please start your questions, and we'll thank you very much. Thank you. Okay, we don't have a first question. Do we have a second question? Right there, please.
Thank you. My name is Volodymyr Dubovik. I'm a Fulbright scholar here at Austin for this academic year. This subject that you've talked about is very special to me. I was a student of history in a Soviet university in Odessa, now Ukraine. I entered the university in 1987, 1 year after Reykjavik, and I wrote my first major research paper on new political thinking in U.S.-Soviet relations, and defended and graduated in 92. And ever since, I'm a professor of international relations. I have two questions. One is on SDI. You talked a lot about it. You made it clear for us to all to know what Reagan thought about it and how Gorbachev felt about it. I would wonder what you thought about SDI as a strategic policy idea back then and what you think about it today and a role it played, if any, in the context of development of bilateral relations. And the second thing, of course, is it's an inevitable question. I think someone else would ask it, if I'm not me. You started by saying that there are some lessons of Reykjavik 40 years later for this incoming new administration here. And you mentioned that maybe president-elect is not exactly Ronald Reagan. But I would also add perhaps that Mr. Putin is perhaps not Mr. Gorbachev. But anyhow, how would you apply the lessons of Reykjavik 40 years later for now? Thank you.
Good. Great questions. Number one, I thought SDI, unlike a lot of the colleagues, I thought SDI was a very good idea. I had written an article in a publication the year before saying we should re-examine whether the prohibition against defenses really made sense with the advent of technology. Intellectually, common sense to say that we are going to restrict offensive, we're going to try to lower offensive arms, but really restrict, prohibit defense, didn't make any sense. Defense is good. Protecting your country is good. And we couldn't do it in the 70s, but we could start to do it by the 80s. And Ronald Reagan wasn't even sure we could do it. He said, let's research it. And it burned me up, to tell you the truth, to hear these scientists in the physicists and in the nuclear, what was that group called? The, applied nuclear scientists or something like that, say SDI will never work. Well, you know, whole hundreds of scientists would sign that. That's the most unscientific thing in the world to say. How do they know it'll never work? We have amazing things right now that were thought to be never working. No scientist would ever say never works unless you were blinded by ideology, which they were, and blinded by hatred of Ronald Reagan, which they also were. But it has been difficult to hit an incoming ballistic missile. The recent tests have been quite positive. We certainly have a defense now that could do very well against a limited nuclear strike from North Korea, from Iran, from a breakaway part of Russia. And to me, that's good enough, okay? It will never defend, never, I don't want to say that. It is very hard to defend against a wholesale attack by Russia. But it's certainly willing to try to give a president of the United States the third button. By that I mean if there was ever detection of an attack against the United States, today a president has the options of either taking it and issuing a press release that it was awfully tragic event, or retaliating against probably millions, if not hundreds of millions, of Russians that had nothing to do with any of this. And tell me the morality of that. The third button would say, I understand, something's coming in, we're gonna shoot it down before it gets here. That's a beautiful vision to really help us in the nuclear age. What are the attributes that we can pick up to use for today? Well, the idea is, number one, treat each other decently, which Ronald Reagan was always very careful about, and which President-elect Trump is not very careful about, to try to work out real differences in a calm, deliberate way while staying true to your values. When you read Reagan at Reykjavik, which I hope you do, and see the transcripts, parts of the conversations between the two of them, Reagan is very frank and very honest with him, and Gorbachev is taking it all in. When Reagan says the superiority of the Western political system, Gorbachev really gives the most pathetic counter-arguments, and you think to yourself, he realizes there are no good counter-arguments for the way the Soviet Union has developed over those 70 years. So I would recommend lessons like that, and to figure out how to get from here to there, which Reagan did. He had his four principles of strategic approach, where Mikhail Gorbachev really wanted perestroika and glasnost and had no idea how to bring in openness and economic reform. He went from system to system, jolting around, and really had no real idea of how to proceed. There's a microphone back there. Last question, okay.
Hello, sir. Lieutenant Colonel Strauss-Gallen, yeah. U.S. Army War College Fellow here at University of Texas, Austin. It's been said that Putin was greatly affected by the fall of the wall in Berlin while he was a KGB officer there.
Right.
How do you think the Reykjavik conference has impacted him? And kind of a continuation with the question, do you think we'll have that kind of breakthrough in the next 4 years with a potential friendship or at least conversations between our future president and President Putin?
Well, according to the London Telegraph of 2 days ago, Trump wants a meeting with Putin at Reykjavik. If you had asked me 4 years before the Reykjavik summit whether we'd ever have anything like that, if you had asked me in 82, will we have an 86 summit in Reykjavik to be so historic, I would have said, no, that is crazy. It is not going to happen. If you asked me back then when I joined the Reagan administration, will we ever have a end of the Cold War, I'd say never. No, that's part of the landscape, and it's never going to happen. Ronald Reagan alone among members of his administration thought there was going to be an end to the Cold War. He alone. We who knew so much more about it than he did were so much, so we thought, smarter than he was, got it wrong, and he got it absolutely right. So I can't say it won't happen. I'm saying that Putin, as this gentleman says, certainly is no Gorbachev. Gorbachev realized they were at the end of the ropes. And if you look at the meetings, which I also included in the book, of the Politburo before the Reykjavik summit, Gorbachev was saying, if there's a new arms race, we're going to lose. We can't win this thing. We got to cut that off. If there's competition on SDI, Strategic Defense Initiative, we're going to lose. We can't compete on SDI. The only thing we can do is try to get reductions in nuclear weapons, which he wanted for the first time at Reykjavik, but to eliminate SDI. So it was a magic moment. Reagan was there. Unlike many of us, he thought there was a new type of Soviet leader. I remember having lunch with the president after meeting with Gorbachev the first time in Geneva in that November of 1985 summit, which I showed you the first 2 minutes of the summit, and the president saying, this is a new type of Soviet leader. And I'm thinking to myself, well, that's nice to know. A, I doubt it, but B, he's never met a previous type of Soviet leader. So how does he know is a new type? But he was right, and we were wrong. And Gorbachev really wanted to change things in a very fundamental way. So I'm saying it's unlikely now. I don't think Donald Trump is any Ronald Reagan. I don't think Vladimir Putin is any Mikhail Gorbachev. But thirdly, I would say I was very wrong in the early 1980s to think anything like this could have ever happened. Now, let me leave you with one last and appropriate part, which is from 1981. Tomorrow is going to be a new inauguration. I'm going to give you a little bit of the 1981 inauguration speech of Ronald Reagan, put to some photos to go with it. And I remember the sense of real excitement that I felt having worked on the transition for Ronald Reagan when he was taking office. And I put this on for you just because of the events that are going to take place tomorrow and to remind you of what a real speaker and a real positive person can really do with an inauguration address, and what someone with a vision and an aspiration of America can really do. Ladies and gentlemen, parts of the 1981 Reagan inaugural address.
If we look to the answer as to why for so many years we achieved so much, prospered as no other people on earth, it was because here in this land, we unleashed the energy and individual genius of man to a greater extent than has ever been done before. Freedom and the dignity of the individual have been more available and assured here than in any other place on earth. The price for this freedom at times has been high, but we have never been unwilling to pay that price. Those who say that we're in a time when there are no heroes, they just don't know where to look. The sloping hills of Arlington National Cemetery, with its row upon row of simple white markers bearing crosses or stars of David, they add up to only a tiny fraction of the price that has been paid for our freedom. Each one of those markers is a monument to the kind of hero I spoke of earlier. Their lives ended in places called Belleau Wood, the Argonne, Omaha Beach, Salerno, and halfway around the world on Guadalcanal, Tarawa, Porkchop Hill, the Chosin Reservoir, and in 100 rice paddies and jungles of a place called Vietnam. Under one such marker lies a young man, Martin Treptow, who left his job in a small town barber shop in 1917 to go to France with the famed Rainbow Division. There on the Western Front, he was killed trying to carry a message between battalions under heavy artillery fire. We're told that on his body was found a diary. On the flyleaf, under the heading My Pledge, he had written these words: America must win this war. Therefore, I will work, I will save, I will sacrifice, I will endure. I will fight cheerfully and do my utmost as if the issue of the whole struggle depended on me alone. We must realize that no arsenal or no weapon in the arsenals of the world is so formidable as the will and moral courage of free men and women. It is a weapon our adversaries in today's world do not have. It is a weapon that we as Americans do have. Let that be understood by those who practice terrorism and prey upon their neighbors. As for the enemies of freedom, those who are potential adversaries, they will be reminded that peace is the highest aspiration of the American people. We will negotiate for it, sacrifice for it. We will not surrender for it now or ever. We are Americans.
Thank you very much, and have a wonderful conference.